Praise the Lord with you for the good visit you had to Bolivia and for the good reporting of the past happenings and what's happening now, along with your son Devin there. That is, was so good to read and good pictures to observe. Second one was from Derek and Kirsten Reimer. Thanks for sharing us about your new employment with Youth for Christ. God bless you as you do your mechanical work and whatever needs to be fixed. Now I know whom to call if I need some fixing. And then there was another one from Chris Harwood on the road with YFC email. And we want to thank God for all of these missionaries who are serving us, serving not us, they're serving the Lord. Let's continue to pray for them. And if you don't get these emails, feel free to ask for them and they'll be happy to share them with you. For the seniors in the church here and who remember Ike and Tina Dirksen, we bring greetings to you from Ike and Tina Dirksen at Donwood Manor. I visited them yesterday. Ike will be 99 this summer, and he's still quite mobile. He lives on his own at Donwood. His wife is in the care section. She has lost it with Alzheimer's, but she's very sweet, and they asked me to send greetings to you. And they so much enjoyed the teenagers when that was an operation. And talking about teenagers, we don't know whether that will ever be revived or not, but some of the younger, older ones should start working on that, I think. Then I would like to say that this is Palm Sunday, and some of the songs have drawn our attention to that. I will not be speaking on Palm Sunday. I've chosen the message, a powerful lesson on forgiveness. And of course, Palm Sunday leads to the cross, and that's where atonement and forgiveness was all worked out on our behalf, and we thank God for that. So I'm encouraging you to listen to God's word as I share, not only to listen, but to hear what the Holy Spirit says to us individually, and then to obey what he would have us to do after the service this coming week. So anything the Lord tells us to do, let's do it. All right, I want to base my message on Matthew 18, the passage that Alma read. Now, if we have a difficult time to forgive, I want you to listen to a story that comes out of Anne Graham Watts' book, The Daniel Key. This is the kind of story, I mean a true life happening, that almost takes my breath away on two counts. The first one being that mankind can be so atrociously evil towards other humans. And the other one is the tremendous power of forgiveness when we allow the Holy Spirit to do that in and through us. Listen to this. A man by the name Azam, a former pirate somewhere in Somalia, today rides in coffins under corpses because he knows Somalia Muslims will not open a casket or touch a dead body, much less look under it. This is how Azam safely travels outside of Somalia, where he then is given a load of Bibles in Kenya. He travels back into Somalia in a coffin, under a corpse, with a precious cargo of God's word, which many people in his area are desperate to read. How could he ever come to the decision to engage in such a mission? Azam had been born and raised a Muslim, but had been having dreams of Jesus. He had sought out his imam for answers, but the man had violently berated and beaten him. And when his mother discovered he was having Jesus dreams, she commanded him to leave the home of his for his own protection and never come back. He did. He walked for miles and miles, quite sure his father would be unable to find him, but he was wrong. His father was a powerful warlord who located him quickly and sent Azam a package. And when I read that, I thought immediately, this will be some kind of explosive to destroy his son. But it wasn't that. When Azam opened it, he was shocked and sickened to find his mother cut up into small pieces. A photograph had been included inside the plastic bag. It was a picture of his mother kneeling in front of two men who had their knives raised over her. The day Hazam opened this package is the day he made a decision, a choice, to commit his life to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. This is where the story gets even more incredible, because Hazam sought out the two men who had butchered his mother. He told me that he forgave them. He also told them that Jesus loved them and that he could forgive murderers. The two men, Mahdi and Yassim, embraced the gospel and chose to commit their lives to Jesus too. Then they confided to Hazam, "As we killed your mother, her last words were, 'Jesus, Jesus, I love you.'" I believe that in the light of that, many of the little things that happen, I mean, many things that happen to are pretty small and should be forgivable, I believe. Let's look, first of all, at the problem here in Matthew 18. There was a relational challenge here that Peter brought up. And we live in a fallen world. There's lots of dysfunctional stuff going on. There's lots of brokenness, and it didn't start in your home or in my family circle, nor in Peter's time. It happened just outside of the Garden of Eden, that place of perfection. All of life is relational. Some of it is wonderful, some of it is good, and some of it is just the pits sometimes. When irritations degenerate to anger and anger to bitterness, and grudges begin to settle within us, or resentment takes hold of us, and there's a desire for revenge, we have to realize that bitterness is like acid that corrodes the container, and not only that, it will usually spit it out and spill it out to others. And so Hebrews 12 reminds us, be careful that you do not allow a root of bitterness to develop. Peter came up with an important relational matter, a question. A brother in his family, or his family of God, I guess had offended, or there was an issue between them two, and it was a bad experience. And you know, Peter might have been totally correct in his assessment of this situation, but there are times when we are as much at fault as the other person is. And also, Peter was often quick to open his mouth, and so we don't always know how right or wrong he might have been. And then there are times when the other person is not in the wrong at all, and we play the blame game. So the question is, how often should I forgive my brother? And apparently the going rate of that day, according to the rabbis, was at least two times. And if you're going to be generous, you forgave three times. And so Peter doubled the rabbinical prescription to six and added one more, seven times. Should I forgive him seven times? He must have thought he was very generous. But I think Christ's reply must have stunned Peter and the other disciples when Jesus said 490 times. 70 times seven. I have a friend here in the city. Once in a while I see his license plate, which says 70 times seven. And I guess when people ask him what that stands for, he can tell the story. Now, 490 times a year, a month, a day, Jesus didn't say that. He just was telling him, this is not a mere matter of math. You do not put a ceiling on forgiveness. Let it be limitless. Just keep on doing it. Let it become a lifestyle with you. Forgive and throw away the calculator. And that's what Hazam in our story did. There's the problem. Let's look at the parable, or the story that Jesus shared here in verses 23 and on. It was time to settle accounts for this one king, leader. One man owed him 10,000 talents, and it is usually thought in our days that might be a million or more. He had a massive debt. If he had stolen it or embezzled it, he had squandered it, it would appear, because he had no means of repaying the king. And the point that is being made is here that from the human standpoint, this servant is in an absolutely hopeless situation, and that's exactly where every sinner, every lost person is. It's a hopeless situation. But you know, And then the sentence is given out in verse 25, and apparently it was quite normal, a normal practice in those days to sell the people. His man is to be sold and his family and his possession, and that would be used as payment for the debt, and of course that amount would only be a pittance compared to what he really owned. Verse 26 points out that he cried out for mercy. Have patience with me, I'll repay. And I say, really? How are you going to do it? Well, that's not the problem here, but anyhow, he cries out for mercy, and something momentous happens. Verse 27, the heart of the king was deeply touched with this plea, and in a compassionate manner, he wiped out totally this man's huge debt, forgave him, and released him, and that's what you call mercy. That's mercy. He got something he did not deserve. He had all of his debt wiped out. And this is so amazing, so absolutely wonderful. And you'd think that he would go and tell his fellow servants and his friends and family, just listen to me. This is what happened. I mean, this is what I owe. This is what the king did. He forgave me. Isn't that wonderful? He could have shared a wonderful testimony. Then we come to verse 8, and I don't like the first word in that verse. It says, but. I don't like that word. Here's a change. Here's a contrast. Now, this man who has been forgiven so much goes to a fellow servant with an unforgiving spirit and unforgiving heart, a man who owes him about 100 denarii, and that's maybe a few hundred dollars or $1,000. The point being that what he owed him was peanuts compared to what he had owed the king. Now this fellow servant also cried for mercy, as he had done before, be patient with me. But there was no mercy, and this, I want to say, is so sad, so awful, so horrendous, so grieving, so unbelievable, so cold, so uncompassionate. And I want us to keep in mind that this is a picture of an unforgiving Christian to somebody else. Verse 31 points out that with grief, the other servants share the sad account with the Lord, their master, because the fellow servants knew about the situation. They were offended and grieved, and they come and tell the king. And when I look at this, I visualize somewhere out there is a believer in a Christian community who has an ongoing issue with somebody else, and others in that Christian community know about it, and they're grieved about it, and they keep telling King Jesus about it in prayer again and again, and something needs to happen. And I want to say that one unforgiving person in any kind of a group can cause offense to the entire congregation. Then we come in verses 32 to 34 to the response of the master now. The king, the master, who was moved with compassion before, now is moved in anger, and he reverses the whole matter, and he has this servant who was so unforgiving, given over to the tormentors, to the torturers, to the jailers. That's the parable. That's the story. You have the problem that Peter brings. You have the parable. Now let's look at some principles to live by. What are some life lessons here? We are all challenged with relationship situations from time to time. I remember a number of years ago when I was pastoring a certain church. We were running two buses, Sunday school buses, picking up children. And a mother, a single mother, had her two children come to our Sunday school. One day this mother called me around noon and asked if I would come over. She was so emotionally stressed, she had to leave work. And she told me that when I die, I want to be buried between my mother and my father so that I can keep them apart even in death. Hebrews 12:15 says, see to it that no one misses the grace of God. There's always grace to work this thing through, but see to it that no one misses the grace of God, and that no root of bitterness grows up to cause trouble and defile many. As mentioned earlier, the bitterness corrodes the container, and it will usually spew it out to other people. Neil Anderson says, we give Satan the greatest opportunity to shipwreck our lives through unforgiveness. I believe that. There have been two specific situations in my life, maybe other lesser ones, but there were two pretty strong situations where the devil sought to put poison into my soul, the poison of bitterness. One was a church-related matter, and the other was a different situation. But in each case, I had to work hard at keeping this thing out of my head, out of our hearts. By an act of the will, push away this bitterness that wants to come in with the help of the Holy Spirit, and God gave us grace. I knew for the fact that if I allowed this to take a root, my ministry would be nil. It would mean nothing. Let me read a story. It comes from the pen of Joe Stowell, who was for a season the president of the big Bible school in Chicago, Moody Bible Institute. Bob always said he wanted a closer walk with the Lord, but he seemed continually frustrated. No matter what he did, his longing for Jesus was never satisfied. He tithed and then some. He served as an elder in the church. He regularly met with God in devotions and prayer. He was good to his wife and spent time with his children. He even fasted on occasion. What else was there to do? Why the frustration and disappointments? The answer goes way back to his childhood days. Bob's dad had left his mother when he was young. So there were the awful memories of the cruel abuse. Bob's dad lived an immoral life. He lived in a town not far from Bob. Bob long ago vowed that he would never forgive his dad. Got it? There is the root problem. So Bob didn't make contact. He refused to move one inch towards the reconciliation. In his mind, this was the last person on earth to merit his love and forgiveness. In this area of Bob's life, so near to the center of his heart, he refused to be conformed to the image of Christ's death. He refused to kneel with Jesus in Gethsemane and face the excruciating prospect of encouraging and forgiving his dad. The words, "Not my will, but yours be done," had not crossed Bob's lips, let alone his heart. In my own mind, when I read something like this, I think of somebody having a pail of water, and he sees that the content is going down, and he keeps on filling up, and the content keeps going down, and he keeps filling it up. And finally, he looks at the bottom of the pail, and there's a hole there. That hole needs to be fixed. A lot of Christians have an emotional leak going on and on because of unconfessed sins or problems like this. They'll keep on doing the good stuff on top, but the root problem is not dealt with. Get the picture? May God help us to deal with that which needs to be dealt with. If we do not forgive others, we imprison ourselves, and we will be plagued with tormentors. Now what about verse 35? My heavenly Father will also do the same to you if each of you do not forgive his brother from their heart. I want us to keep this in mind, that this is addressed to followers of Christ. The Lord is addressing Peter and the other disciples. He's talking about your heavenly Father. So this is a lesson. This lesson is to born-again people who are fully forgiven and given salvation. But, sadly, there are Christians with an unforgiving spirit, and their journey through life is not nearly as happy, as good, as strong as it could be because of underlying issues. I think of two men right now. One is 90-plus and one is 68. If their course of life and their Christian walk does not change, I don't think they'll die happy Christians. Simply simply because there is an issue or two, and every so often this floating bitterness comes up again, and this thing is mentioned again, and then it's gone for a while, and then it comes up again. These things need to be dealt with thoroughly. Tormentors, God allows tormentors to come into our lives, and that has to do with misery, loss of assurance, not loss of salvation, but loss of assurance, unhappiness, anger, wrong emotions, attitudes that are not good, even as we see in Bob's case that we read about. Christians who refuse to give others will subject themselves to discipline, and sometimes severe discipline, until they learn to forgive as they have been forgiven. So the tortures represent the rod of God's discipline. Neil Anderson again says, I believe that the greatest access Satan has to the church in waging war for our minds is an unwillingness to forgive. Well, let's quickly mention three key lessons, life lessons that we could emphasize. And the first one is simply this: practice forgiveness. Practice forgiveness. Make it a part of your lifestyle, your daily living. Seek to forgive quickly, immediately. Someone cuts you off in the road and you fume for 3 hours, that's not very good. You need to take care of that much more quickly. I know that there are deep-seated issues that often cannot be forgiven in a short little time. It takes time to work through them, but allow the Holy Spirit to do that. May it become a way of life, learning to live with a spirit of forgiveness. Ernest Hemingway, in one of his books, tells about a Spanish father who wanted to be reconciled with his runaway son. The despairing father missed his son so much that he placed an advertisement in the local newspaper. The advertisement read simply, Paco, meet me at Hotel Montana at noon on Tuesday. All is forgiven. Love, Papa. But Paco is a very common name in Spain. And when the father went to the hotel next day, there were dozens of young men waiting for their forgiving fathers. Practice forgiveness. Now somebody might ask, why should I forgive? Number one, we should forgive because it's commanded. Jesus doesn't only wish for us to forgive. It's a command, Ephesians 4 and Colossians 3. Secondly, we need to forgive for our own health's sake. Our own health's sake, your spiritual health, your emotional health, your physical health. We take responsibility for what we need to do. I know what this is all about, and I know that I have the greatest peace of mind and heart when I deal a lot with these things carefully and fully. And that way we can be a clean channel through whom God can work. And then also we need to forgive for the sake of the other person that we have an issue with. Regardless of how that person responds, our duty is to do the forgiving. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. By the way, there is a principle in Romans 12, 18, and that's where I park on sometimes. When somebody is not wanting to communicate or doesn't want to forgive, then I park on Romans 12, 18. As much as lies in you, live peaceably with all men. You do your part, you forgive. You keep your door open for further communication, you go on with life. So, forgiving is not a feeling, it's a choice. 70 times 7. Thomas Fuller wrote, the noblest revenge is forgiveness. So, three key lessons about this matter is, number one is, practice forgiveness. And then secondly, I want to suggest to keep seeking a right focus. Now, the focus is when somebody has hurt me, I think about that guy. I think about that problem. And that's where my mind wants to go. But you know what? We need to look this way and look at Jesus and look at Calvary. He is our supreme example, and we need to hear him once more say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. And then listen to it and hear it again and again as needed. Look looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. So in this story, in this parable, Jesus is the one who forgave us the debt we could never pay. This is what this lesson is all about. He paid this huge debt for us. Christ fully forgave us, totally freed us from our burdens. Now we can have, we should have a forgiving heart as Jesus Christ had to others. Be merciful to those who have wronged us. And so our focus needs to be on him, Jesus, and see what he would have us do. You see, anger, resentment, and bitterness are rooted in self, spurred on by the devil, while our forgiving others is rooted in the forgiving heart of Jesus, his command, and his empowerment. I want to reread that. Anger, resentment, bitterness is rooted in self and spurred on by the devil, while our forgiving others is rooted in the forgiving heart of Jesus. He commands it, and he will empower us to do that. You see, Jesus did not have the spirit of a lion when he died on the cross. He didn't say, okay, you guys, you just wait till I get back to my throne. I'll get even with you. I'll really claw you at that time. Jesus had the spirit of a lamb. He was the Lamb of God, and he was willing to die for the perpetrators and forgive them as well. So let's practice forgiveness. Seek to get a right focus, and that is Jesus. And then, of course, in the last part of this chapter, true forgiveness must be from the heart. From the heart. The servant who was forgiven so much was happy, but he only heard the message with his ears and his head. That truth never filtered into his heart, for if it had, he would not have taken the action against his fellow servant the way he did. And so the Lord is always concerned about the heart. Proverbs 4:23, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. How's your heart today? What's in it? Is it clean? Is that a forgiving heart? Or are you having a closet or two where you want to keep some personal revenge and make you unhappy? We are never more like Jesus than when we forgive. Born again people have a new nature, and that includes a forgiving nature as like unto Jesus. C.J. Mahoney says, because we are the most forgiven people in the world, we should be the most forgiving people in the world. Forgive fully, totally from the heart, and as I would tell young couples sometimes in premarital counseling, bury all cattails. What does that mean? Well, you know, when a cat dies, finally lost its ninth life, you bury it and don't let the tail stick out. You know, that's what some people do. They want to, yes, we'll forgive, but they leave the tail out, and when the appropriate time comes, they grab that old stinking cat and say, you know what you did back then to me? Bury all cat tails. Well, we could say a few other things, but I'm going to close here with that, and I want to read an email. I shared this message somewhere else some time ago, and 2 days after that particular Sunday, this came from a young mother who has one young boy. She and her husband are expecting the second child. I just want to say I really enjoyed your message on Sunday. I have struggled with forgiving people in my life, but in the last 4 years, I have forgiven more than I thought I would ever forget. Forgive. My biological father wasn't a good father to me. He molested me for 5 years when I was a teenager. I have never felt wanted by him. 4 years ago, I told him I forgive him for everything he's done to me. Only with God's strength, was I able to do that. Now I pray for my father as he's a Christian, that he finds the Lord. That he isn't a Christian and that he finds the Lord. Your message was personal to me. It challenged me to look into my life to see if there were other people for forgiveness for. I want us to listen to a song now by Matthew West on forgiveness, and then I will come back and conclude the morning. Three scripture verses that begin with the word if. Psalm 66, 18.
If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me.
But, 1 John 1, 9. If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then, John 8, 36. If the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. See the progression? If I regard, keep sin in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. If we confess, he'll forgive. And if the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Let's bow our heads. Have a silent moment or two or three and just reflect on some of the things that we've heard this morning. And see if there's anything that the Holy Spirit is pointing out to us to be thinking of in the days ahead. To be even a better vessel of honor for God and his glory. And if the Lord is pointing out something very specific, seek by the grace of God to deal with it. Father, if there's anybody here this morning that has never found peace with God, has never been born again, may they find the forgiveness at the foot of the cross, even today, where you're willing to forgive and take that person in as one of your wonderful children into your forever family. And Father, for the rest of us who know you, may it be our desire to continuously have clean hands and pure hearts in your presence and in the presence of other people. And we want to pray on a continuing way. If there's something that is standing in the way and that needs to be dealt with, show it to us, Father. Search our hearts and know us and point it out to us. Because we want to honor and glorify you, and we want to see your work going forward without being fettered by wrong stuff in our own lives. Thank you for these dear people, and I pray, Lord, that you would bless each and every one this week. We want to go in your name. May we go in your peace, and may we go in your strength, and give us a good week as we look forward to Good Friday and Easter. And we also look forward to the soon return of Jesus Christ, and that would be so wonderful to be raptured away soon. Bless us and guide us, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, folks.